welcome to this course OEV 112, lecture 1, which is the course of environmental management, ethics and philosophy. My name is Dr. Joseph Atisaria, senior lecturer at the Faculty of Science and Department of Environmental Studies. Basically, this course is for the management stream, and to start up with, this course bridges the three key concepts, which is the environmental ethics and environmental philosophy, as well as environmental management. In this course, we have raised important issues, and we have used a rich supplement of past and current knowledge to enable learners to meet their academic needs by using different examples, the current examples of what is happening in Tanzanian society. We've raised the basic questions, and also we have told the compelling stories which relates to our environment and offer a range of philosophical responses as contemporary strategy vital to growing environmental issues of Tanzania today. By the time philosophy, this is concerned with the question like why and how. In the same vein, philosophy of the environment raises rational questions emanating from wondering about why the society is destroying the ecosystem that support human life, and how and why rational being advanced technologically should let destruction to happen at all. The environmental ethics, to start up with, is this one gives a broad way of thinking about how human being ought to act responsibly in order to achieve a good life through environment, just as philosophy was concerned from time immemorial during the Big Bang. We answer the questions like, what is reality? What constitutes a knowledge someone has? And what are values? And what constitutes truth of the argument? The importance of this course, environmental studies, cannot be disputed. The need for sustainable development is the key function to the future of mankind. Basically, we want our new generation to inherit the good things and not the bad things. The destruction of our environment is linked to continuing problems of pollution, loss of forest, solid waste disposal, issues related to economic productions and national as well as economical security. The increased level of global warming, the depletion of the ozone layer, and the serious loss of biodiversity have also made everyone aware of growing environmental concerns. This is the aspect which will be discussed later in the environmental management section. The objective of this course, we have five objectives which will be leading our course. One is to explain the relationship between environmental management, environmental ethical behavior, and the individuals as well as society as the country. The second one is to describe how different ethical perspectives shape our environmental behavior. The third one is to explain how different philosophical perspectives deals with human nature relationships. The fourth one is to demonstrate an understanding of the role of technology in causing environmental problems as well as help us to solve those environmental problems. And the last one is to describe issues related to environmental impact assessment and the environmental monitoring system benefits, roles, and the strategies. The environmental management ethics and philosophy give a broad way of thinking of about how human beings, we've said how human beings ought to act responsibly in order to achieve the good life through the environment. We don't want the environment to be destroyed. But the term philosophy, this one emanates from the roots of Greek word, philo means wisdom, and sophia means love of. Therefore, when two senses are combined, philosophy connoted to be love of the wisdom. Philosophy tries to answer the questions like, what is reality? What constitutes knowledge? And what are values? And what constitutes truth of the argument? Therefore, environmental management can be, in other words, can be referred as goal, vision, to attempt to steer a process to application of the set of tools to philosophical exercise, seeking to establish new perspective towards environment and human society, and too much more besides. Environmental managers, when we talk about the environmental managers, these are a diverse group of people like academicians, policymakers, NGO workers, company employees, civil servants, and wide range of individuals or groups who make decisions about the use of natural resource. Anyway, we have used the word natural resource. What is this natural resource? The natural resource are resources that exist without the action of humankind. They are naturally occurring, like mining, water, air. These are the natural resources. Sunlight, atmosphere, land, minerals, vegetations, crops, and animal life that naturally subsists upon or within the previously identified characteristics and substances. Natural resource management refers to the sustainable utilization of major natural resources, which they are known to provide fundamental life support in the form of both consumptive and public good services. Now, to go up with this course, we have divided into 6 knowledge areas. And today I would like to go through this, the first part, which is the first knowledge area, which is to know about the philosophy. Philosophy has 4 different branches. These 4 branches are metaphysics, epistemology, logic, and axiology. Let's start up with the metaphysics. The word metaphysics is derived from 2 Greek words. Meta means beyond, upon, or after. And physica means physics. Therefore, metaphysics is a study about reality. The word reality refers to those issues including existence, the relationship between mind and body, object and their properties, events and the caution. This metaphysics is divided into 5 different branches, sub-branches. The sub-branches of metaphysics are cosmology. 1. Cosmology. Cosmology is the study about the universe concept in the universe. cosmology is the branch of, we can say cosmology is the branch of astronomy, which is concerned with the study of the origin and the evolution of the universe. In here, we normally talk about the Big Bang. Since the Big Bang, people, the astronomies, they normally think about how the universe is. The second branch is called ontology. This is the study of beings, particularly becoming, existence, reality, as well as basic categories of being and their relationship. The third branch of metaphysics is called theology. This is a study about the supernatural power. Who made up the world? People are saying God exists. Satan exists. Those ideas are the sub-branch of metaphysics, which are called the theology. The fourth one is called theodicy. This is the study about the supernatural being. Like, you can ask yourself, why devil? Why God permit devil to do this? What is the devil? Those are theodicy. And the last one, which is the fifth one, is anthropology. This is the study of ethnicity concept about human beings, human behavior and society in the past and present. The study of people like Maasai people, how those Maasai people differ from Chaga people, those are called anthropology. Now, the study of the universe, how the nature was, this one was studied from very long time by most of the philosophers like Plato. And Plato studied the problems of the universe. This one disturbed him, and he concluded that reality exists in mind where all concepts emanate. The problem that Plato faces led to a fundamental question of what is the reality? Therefore, metaphysics is the type of philosophy or study that uses broad concepts to help define reality in our understanding of the problem. Therefore, metaphysics must include the study of nature of the humankind, the definition and the meaning of the existence, or the nature of the space, time, and the causality. The second one is called epistemology. Epistemology, we have said epistemology is coming from Greek word episteme, means knowledge, and ology means study of. Therefore, epistemology is the study of knowledge. It is concerned with the nature and scope of the knowledge, such as a relationship between truth, belief, and theories of justification. Epistemologists attempt to construct theories that are synoptic, descriptively, accurately, explanatory, powerful, and in all other respects, rational, defensible. They are often beginning their speculations with the assumption that they have a great deal of knowledge. The third branch is axiology. This is branch coming from Greek word axio, means custom, and ology, study of. Therefore, axiology is the study of customs, culture, or general values. Therefore, axiology is further divided into subgroups. Sub-branches of the axiology are, one, ethics. We can say ethics or moral. What is moral in you? What builds you about the environment? And the second one is aesthetics, which means study of beautifulness of the world, the art, the makeup of the person. What is, you can look on the environment, looking on insects. When you look on birds, how beautiful are they? How good are they? That is aesthetics. Therefore, the combination of these two, these sub-branches, ethics and aesthetics, this one build up a branch of philosophy called axiology. The ethics as a branch of philosophy involves systematizing, defending, and recommending concepts of right and wrong behavior. Because we have said ethics is moral built of someone. What is the behavior in you? When you start cutting up a very good trees, when you start killing up of the birds. In simple language, ethics or moral philosophy is concerned with primarily with the question, how does a human being ought to act? The issue of ought to act is central in ethics. Authentics, this is the judgment or sentiment and test. This is a critical reflection on art, culture, and nature, dealing with the nature of beautifulness, art, and taste, and with the creation and the admiration of beautifulness. When you admire something, there must be issues you have to consider. When you admire the environment, when you admire animal like lion, issues to consider for the admiration, one is the strength of the part of some design. Look on the muscles, on their legs, on their neck. The second one is diversity, which is the uniformity in as many ways as possible. Looking on lion, let's take our example of lion. The diversity, the uniformity. The third one, you look on consistency, regularity or proportion, which is only beautiful when it helps to defend the characteristics of suitability. The fourth one is simplicity or focus, which give happiness, not in itself, but through its enabling the eye to enjoy range with ease. The fifth one is the sophistication, which provides employment for our dynamic energies, leading the eye on a justifiable kind of pursuit. And the last one is quantity or scale, which draw our consideration and produces admiration. The last branch is called logic or argument. This is a formal systematic study of the principle of valid inferences and correct reasoning. This one also is divided into two groups, subgroups. One is called deductive argument. The deductive argument asserts that the truth of the conclusion is logical consequences of the premises. For example, you give the premises like A equals to B and B equals to C. Then the conclusion follows necessarily that A must be equal to C. Let's take an example. We are human beings. We are human beings. And you say all human beings die. Juma is a human being. Therefore, conclusion will be Juma will die. This is what we call deductive. You start from the conclusion and then you give up the premises. The second one is called an inductive argument. This has said that the truth of the conclusion is supported to some degree of probability by the premises. Inductive reasoning involved drawing conclusion from the facts using logical assumptions, let's say like the experimentations. For example, we are saying when you are doing research in the environment, you say 95% of interviews knows about the environmental pollution. Therefore, a randomly selected people at the selected area probably knows the environmental pollution. Therefore, you have done your research. You find that about 95% knows about the issue of the environment. Therefore, you conclude by saying the entire population knows about the pollution. To summarize up on these branches of philosophy, we have said we have different philosophy, branches of philosophy, five of them. One is the metaphysics. We say this is the study of existence. And the question you can ask yourself is, what out there? What is there? The second one is epistemology. Epistemology is the study of knowledge. The question you can ask yourself is, how do I know about it? Then we have the ethics. This is the study of action. You can raise a question about the ethics on what should I do now? And in ethics, we have euthentics, study of the art. The question you can raise is like, what can life be like? Now, after studying this broad term, the philosophy, and knowing about the branches of philosophy, let's go straight to our environmental philosophy. The environmental philosophy, this is the term defined as a branch of philosophy that is concerned with the natural environment and humans placed within this environment. We have used the word environment here. What is environment? Environment, as it is, refers to physical, cultural, social, political, and economics that surrounded the human beings. Everything which surrounded the human being, either it is physical, living or non-living, culture, social perspectives, political, economics, that's what we say, that's the human environment. You can now, taking up those branches of philosophy and bringing up to this environmental philosophy. For example, the metaphysics of the environment. The basic question you can ask here is, what is the environmental reality? Epistemology of the environment. What is the content of the knowledge about the environment? What should we know about this one environment? Axiology of the environment. What are the values that underlie the environment? Logic of the environment. The question you can ask here is, what are the truthfulness argument versus fallacy on the theories of the environment? Now, let's look on the branches of environmental philosophy. One branch, big branch of the environmental philosophy is called environmental ethics. This is the discipline in philosophy that studies the moral relation of human beings to and also the values and moral status of the environment and its non-human content. It is concerned on human beings' ethical relations with the natural environment. There are many, in today, there are many ethical decisions that human beings made with respect to the environment. One of the decision is coming from this question. A, should human beings continue to cut forests, the deforestation, for the sake of human consumption? If you want to make up a charcoal, this is a very big question. That is it ethical? Is it ethical for humans to continue cutting trees just to make up charcoal? To clear up bushes if they want to plant crops? B, why should human beings continue to propagate its species and life itself? C is coming from what we are doing, that should human continue to make gasoline vehicles while this one is giving a lot of carbon dioxide and bringing up the global warming? D, what environmental obligations do human need to keep for future generation? Do we want future generation to inherit the destructed world? D, ethical question is it right for human to knowingly cause the extinction of species for the convenience of humanity? E, how should humans best use and conceive the space environment to secure and expand life? And last one is, what role can planetary boundaries play in reshaping the human-Earth relationship? These are what we call ethical questions. The second one is ecofeminism. This is the branch. This branch is a social and a political movement which point to the existence of considerable common grounds between environmentalism and feminism, with some current link in deep ecology and feminism. Ecofeminism is in activists. These are activists and the academic movement that seek critical connections between the domination of nature and exploitation of women. They are really ecofeminists. They were just looking on oppressions on women, how women were oppressed in terms of what they are doing on the environment. This one started up in 1980s to 90s among women from the anti-nuclear countries, environmentalist and lesbian feminist movements. The third one is ecotheology. This is the form of constructive theology that focuses on the interrelationships of the religion and nature, particularly in the light of environmental concern. Ecotheology here generally starts from findings the relationship between human religious, spiritual worldwide, and the degradation, preservation of the nature. It explores the interaction between ecological values such as sustainability and the human domination of the nature. And In the this sub-branch ecotheology, we get those people like Christianity, we get those people like Muslim, we get those people, even those people who doesn't have any side. Let's look on the Christianity movement about the environment, Christianity and the environment. The best and the first one is what is written in the Bible, in Exodus 1, version 28, which say God gave man the power to dominate the world and exploit for his survival and his prosperity. This mandate, which is written in the Bible, gave a man said to have been misused and for some times has been responsible for causing environmental degradation. Because humankind, the Christianity, Christians were thinking that they have the power of everything under this sphere, and they start destructing up the world, and they exist in today's environmental crisis. It also arises in response to what has been called the ecological complaints about the Christianity. Therefore, Christianity, those Christians, they start up the movement of dealing up with the destructions of the environment. By the very fact of creation, the world carries traces of Christ, because all things came to be through him, and without him nothing came to be. This is John 1 version 3. People were saying that all things came through him, and without him there could be nothing. And in him all things hold together. Colossians 1 version 13. 1 Corinthians 8 version 6. Therefore, Christians' incarnation was concerned before every creation. Christ is the firstborn of all creations. Colossians 1 version 15, and its supreme archetype. Therefore, through the incarnation in time, creation was in the sense assumption into through the Christ. It becomes part of his mystical ontological constitution. Therefore, in Christ, the whole world and not just mankind is reconciled with God. Therefore, all these versions, and when you read also like Romans 8 version 18 to 21, which say through Christ, glorification creation like human beings is given eternal and blessed destiny. It is for this glorious destiny that creation shines in all depth and weight with so much anxiety. That people start to think about these versions and they think of destroying up the environment. Therefore, Christianity movement started up in 19th century, and they told people, the movement think that we should stop destroying our environment for the betterment of our people to come. Therefore, that is moral and ethical level. We know our moral obligation to other and to God, but to creation. Is there such things as ecological justice? There is a fierce debate about whether the things of nature have right and duties. Are they really ethical or legal subjects? This made the Christianity to be more involved in the movement with their people, who believe that the nature of the environment is very important and we should not destroy the environment. Looking on the other corner, the Islamic belief about the environment. The Islam believe that environment, climate change, pollution, etc., have occupied worldwide attention. And it affects Arabs and Muslims since 1980s. And they believe, Quran say that Allah, who is also a God, is the creator of the world. Muslims believe that human beings are on the world as trustees only. They are told to look after the world for Allah and for the future. That's the belief of Islams. In Quran, Muslims are instructed to look after the environment and not to damage it. It is written in Surah 30, version 30, that devote thyself single-mindedly to the faith and thus follow the nature designed by Allah, the nature accordingly to which He has fashioned mankind. There is no altering the creation of Allah. Muslims have to look after the earth because it is all Allah's creation and it is part of human duty to Allah. Muslims believe that we are here as the trustees only, and everything which is made in the world, it has its own purpose, and we are trustees to protect them and not to kill them and destroy them. They believe Allah is He who raised up the heavens without any pillar that you can see. Then He set to Himself on the throne and constrained the sun and moon to serve you. Each planet pursues its course during appointment terms. He regulates it all and expounds the signs that you may have firm belief in the meeting with your Lord. Quran say, when you look on the Quran, you say, He is who spread out the earth and made therein firmly fixed mountains and rivers and fruits of every kind. He has made pairs. He caused the night to cover the day. In all this, verily, a signs door a people who reflect. Surah 13, version 3-4. Therefore, we are just the trustees for Allah and not to destroy what we were given. For example, Muslims believe that air pollution, where the Lord has raised up the heaven without the pillars, the destruction of air pollution is not acceptable by Allah. Let's look on the other corner, which is paganism, those people who don't believe in any. Paganism, these are natural-based religion that exist in a multitude of forms. There is no official doctrine or sacred text that structure its practice. Many pagans believe that it should be used as a tool to combat the current ecological crisis, because it is flexible and can adapt to the environmental need. Paganism combines religion with the environment activism. Paganism organizes, these paganists in Europe, they organize protests, campaigns, petitions with the environment in mind while staying true to their religious beliefs. Paganism, who are based mostly in UK, recognize the earth as sacred and divine. There are four goals for this paganism when we relate to the environment. One, the goal of their movement was to increase general awareness of the sacredness of the earth. Two, to encourage pagans to become involved in conservation work and cleaning up of the environment. The third one is to encourage pagans to become involved in environmental campaigns. And the last one is to develop the principles and practices of magical and spiritual action of the environment. As a human being now, as a human being, either Christian, Muslim, pagan, we need a new sort of what eternal romanticisms that dwell in the human soul. We need romanticisms that is more aware of our feelings of communion with nature as part of universal brotherhood under the eye of who we believe, either Christian or Muslim or pagan. We must see everything with the eye of children, poets, and saints. We must once more look at creation with the eye of wonder. How good this environment is. How it were before. What was the nature? Dear students, we need to protect our environment. We have built up all concepts from the beginning to now that even what we believe, they have the concept of environmental protection. We need to be managers. We need to know the theories of how we can protect our environment and make it pristine. In here, we give up the stories, the history, how the movement goes from the time of human creation, Big Bang, to date about the environmental management, environmental protection. And we know this philosophy, how people were thinking from Plato to date to protect our environment. This one marks the end of this lecture. In the coming lecture, which is the second series, part two, we'll discuss about the environmental management and its ethics. And here, we'll discuss about the background to the environmental ethics, fundamental questions addressing the environmental ethics, categories of environmental ethics. The big question we'll ask is, why should us bother about this environmental management? What is the environmental management system, EMS? What are the requirements of the international standard such as ISO 14001? What are the fundamentals of the environmental management? I think you will enjoy the forthcoming lecture series. With this, I'm saying thank you very much for listening and good luck.